Good morning, student. Today I am going to explain you the digestive system in fish. In our previous lecture, we have studied about the feeding habits in the fish. So the digestive system of fish, it shows a huge plasticity due to the different feeding strategies that are available in the aquatic environment. The digestive tract ranges from a tubular structure without any anatomical differentiation to a developed digestive tract with a defined muscular stomach and even specialized structures such as gill rakers. As we have seen in most vertebrates whose digestion begins in the oral cavity, but fish, they lack salivary glands in the oral cavity. Means salivary glands are absent in the oral cavity. Therefore, the chemical digestion begins in the stomach or directly in the intestine or gut. So the nutrient they are absorbed within the gut only. So the main characteristic difference that we are seeing in the vertebrate in fishes is that they don't have salivary glands in the oral cavity. Now coming to the next, the first element of the digestive system, as we know, is mouth, and different type of feeders have specific mouth that is suited to their diet and feeding behavior. We have studied in fishes, so their mouth is according to their feeding behavior. When the fish close their mouth, the food is trapped there and excess water is pushed out. Ab jab food aaya to kya hoga? Food particles, they get trapped inside the mouth and excess water, pani ke sang aa raha hai, and excess water is pushed out of the gills. Fish, especially those that eat other fish, they have extraordinary large mouth because they have to accommodate the large prey when they catch them. The digestive tract is composed of a tubular structure and it has four regions: the oral cavity, an initial region, it is composed of esophagus, stomach, pylorus, and a medium portion of long length where the pyloric end, it is blind and it can be found, and a terminal region which ends into the anus. So this is the composition of the digestive tract of a fish. Now coming to the digestive system, how it is varying in the fishes. The digestive system includes the alimentary canal, the associated glands, and the alimentary canal or the gut, it shows four distinct regions. As you see in the diagram, ingress, when the fishes, they have ingressive zone, progressive zone, depressive zone, and the aggressive zone. Ingressive, progressive, depressive and aggressive zone, it is the alimentary canal is according to that. Now as you see here, the mouth, when the fishes, they are preying on other fishes, they have a huge mouth. So mouth, it is the anterior opening of the alimentary canal. When most fishes, they have mouth, it can be categorized into three general types. Superior mouth, as you can see, the fish, the mouth is so big. Terminal mouth, the fish which is laying aside, and the inferior mouth which is lower side, as we can see in omnivorous fishes. Now teeth, after mouth there is teeth. Teeth are generally what, they are hollow cones like dentine and they contain the pulp cavities. As you see here, absence of teeth in case of caprinoids. Caprinoids, they don't have teeth, which have, they have got pharyngeal teeth instead of the normal teeth. Means pharynx, it is having the teeth and this is helping in crushing and grinding the prey in caprinoids. Pharyngeal teeth are located below and above the pharyngeal arches. As you can see here in the diagram, they don't have a true teeth, but they have the pharyngeal teeth, example the caprinoids. Then coming to the buccal cavity, pharynx and gill rakers. Here you can see in the diagram, the buccal cavity and pharynx, they are not clearly marked off from each other. They are not marked. A number of perforation of gill slits, they are located on each side of the pharyngeal gill. Here you can see the gill slits in the diagram, they are located on either side of the pharyngeal wall, and the primary function of the gill rakers is to protect the gill filaments from injury and to assist the fish in the process of ingestion. As you can see here on the side, the gill rakers are there, and then in the whole diagram you can see how they are helping in the ingestion of the food particles. Now, in different categories of the fishes, if you see omnivorous fishes, in omnivorous fishes, example Puntia serrana, the gill rakers, they are short and stumpy. But in herbivorous like Labiorhoeta, Ceranum regla, the gill rakers, they form a broad sieve-like structures across the gill slits. Why? For filtering the water in order to retain the food in the buccopharyngeal apparatus. As you can see here in the buccopharyngeal apparatus. Now, in case of carnivorous fishes, the gill rakers, they are long. See, you can see in the diagram, they are so long and teeth-like, forming rasping organs, as in Valegoattu, Mr. Singhala and Chana stratus. Coming to the esophagus, after that esophagus come, the pharynx, they are open into behind the esophagus. They have large number of mucus secreting cells which are scattered in the mucosa. The taste buds, they also present, example in Labiorhoeta, Carbio, Katla, Katla. Short and narrow tube in case of herbivorous and omnivorous fishes, example Labiorhoeta, Puntia serrana, Cyprinus, Carpio, etc. Now you can see in the diagram here, large and distensible tube is seen in case of carnivorous and predatory fishes such as Valegoattu and Heteropneustis fossalis. As in the diagram, you can see the esophagus and the stomach. Next is the stomach. The stomach, it acquires different shape according to the availability of space in the body cavity of different fishes. The stomach, it is divided into anterior part and the posterior part. The anterior part is called as the cardiac stomach and the posterior part is called as the pyloric stomach. All fishes do not possess a true stomach, as it is absent in most of the fishes. They are absent in herbivorous fishes like Labiorhoeta, Katla, Katla, etc. So in which fishes true stomach is absent? Herbivorous fishes. In such fishes, the anterior part of the intestine, it is swollen to form a sac-like structure called intestinal bulb. So anterior part of the intestine, it is forming the intestinal bulb. A true stomach is present in carnivorous and predatory fishes, example the Chana stratus, Mr. Singhala, etc. Coming to the carnivorous fishes, here you can see the stomach, it is generally sac-like and thick-walled in carnivorous and predatory fishes. In omnivorous fishes, how we can see, example Puntiasophore, Cyprinus carpio, some fishes like Hilsa elitia, Agudusia, the stomach is reduced in size but is greatly thickened to form gizzard-like for the digestion of the food. So omnivorous fishes, they are having this type of stomach, as you can see in the diagram. In the next diagram, it is very clear when the fishes, they eat other fishes, you can see in the diagram, they have so big stomach. In marine fishes, you can see the diagram, it is hanging stomach, and in omnivorous fishes, they have a big stomach. Now you can see a beautiful diagram. In this, the puffer fish, the stomach is extending out. When the fish is scared, the stomach, it is coming out of the body. You can see here in puffer fish, the stomach, it is enclosing the whole body. Now coming to the pyloric cieca, anterior part of the intestine, it gave rise to a number of finger-like outgrowths called pyloric or intestinal cieca. This pyloric cieca, they serve as accessory food reserve. This is means when abundant food is there, then it is reserved here, so it is also called as accessory food reserve. Histologically, intestinal cieca, they resemble the intestine and probably serve to enhance the absorptive area. They are increasing the absorptive area of the fishes. The intestine, the part of the alimentary canal that follows the stomach, is called intestine and divided into two parts. The anterior part is the small intestine and the posterior part is the large intestine. The small intestines are just behind the stomach and they receive ducts from the liver and pancreas, and it is called as duodenum, while rest part is called the ileum. So which part is called as the duodenum? The small intestine, which is behind the stomach, it receives the duct from the liver and than the pancreas. So it is called as duodenum. There is no clear cut demarcation between the small intestine and the large intestine in case of fishes. The length of the intestine, it depends upon the feeding habit of the fish. What type of feeding habit fish has, the length of the intestine will depend on that. In fish, anterior proximal intestine may be used instead of duodenum. In teleost, intestines is relatively short, typically around 1.5 times the length of the fish body. It has a number of pyloric cicae with small pouches-like structure. So, these pyloric cicae, they have small pouch-like structure. There is no ileocecal valve in teleost and the rectum being marked only by the end of the digestive epithelium. If we see in non-teleost fish, small intestine is absent, such as sharks, sturgeons and lungfishes. Instead, the digestive tract part of the gut, it forms a spiral intestine connecting to the stomach to the rectum. Now, in lamprey, the spiral valve, it is extremely small. So, the absorptive area will be small. In hagfishes, they have no spiral valve at all. So, digestion, it occurs along the entire length of the intestine. In shark, a rectal gland is present that secretes salt to help the animal maintain its osmotic balance with the seawater. Now, rectum. In many fishes, rectum has mucus secreting cell, example the tetradon. In carnivorous fishes, intestines is reduced. In herbivorous fishes, it is elongated. And in omnivorous, it is intermediate. So, you can see the diagram here. With different colors, it has been marked as mouth, esophagus, stomach, pyloric cicae, midgut, hindgut, the gallbladder and the gizzard. So, you can see in eel, in salmonids, in baleni and in the mullets, the different. So, finally coming to the conclusion that the structure of the alimentary canal, it varies in different species of the fishes and generally adapted in relation to the food and feeding habit, alimentary canal. The variations are seen in the position of the mouth, architecture of the buccopharynx length, the gut present, absence of the stomach and the pyloric cicae. If you see the digestive system, of ant means it is associated with the alimentary canal. It contains intramural glands which provide tube, which are provided with tubes for lubricating mucus, enzymes in water. And then there are extramural glands such as liver, pancreas and the gallbladder. So these are the various parts. In fishes, we have discussed about how many types, the mechanical digestion and the chemical digestion. In chemical digestion, what is happening? The stomach, if it is present, it is having the secreting the hydrochloric acid and this pepsin enzyme for digestion, the digesting the proteins. And this is the chemical digestion. In chemical digestion, enzymes are associated. In mechanical digestion, there is crushing of the food. So, as vertebrates only, the digestion is occurring, but the main difference is the fishes, they don't have the salivary gland and the feeding habit is according to the different type of the mouth parts, alimentary canal, stomach and the nature of the feeder, whether it is herbivore, carnivore, omnivore. So, that is according to it. So, hope you have understood. And as usual, I am ending my lecture with a question. So, give me the example of the fish in which stomach is absent. And you are going to reply in the comment box. Hope you have understood. And we are going to study our next physiology topic in our next lecture. Till then, goodbye. Thank you. No.